Magnetopulse. Love your channel. If one is recovering from an event 1 year ago with stents, is K2 risky? No. So here's the rest of that question. Is K2 risky in that it might destabilize existing non-stented plaques? You see this comment, this question quite a bit. And actually, if you look back on my videos when I first started looking at K2, I wondered about that as well. John Lorscheider, when he was active with our channel, felt very strongly that that was a potential possibility. The more I study this, the less I believe that K2 is actually going to destabilize a plaque. A couple of things. Number one, as we mentioned already in the program, K2 helps decrease insulin resistance. So insulin resistance is not going to destabilize a plaque. And here's the other thing. If you're removing plaque, so John's video was a great example of this. He actually decreased his calcium score by what? 59%, 60% over an 18-month period. We had another video from another volunteer named Jerry Kurth. He reversed his calcium score by about 20%. And here's the thing. Does anybody think that either John or Jerry actually destabilized their plaque when they removed the calcium? Not at all. And within John's case, he lost like 40 pounds. Jerry stabilized a lot of things. It was clear from the rest of their case discussion for these individuals, they were clearly getting more healthy, not less. So if you lost 30 pounds, you start reducing some of that plaque, or lost 40 like John did and start reducing some of that plaque, the calcium that way, if you gained all of that weight and you got a decrease in calcium, yes, I would be worried that you've destabilized your plaque at that point. But when you're doing it by K2 and weight loss and some of the things that we know improves your health, I don't think that's going to destabilize the plaque so much as it is just naturally and safely reverse it. I'll just start off with the question, you know, do I take it? Yes, I do. How much? We get that question a lot. Most supplements, you'll get like these K2, D3 supplements, and you'll typically see 100 micrograms of K2 in that supplement. The randomized clinical trials that I've seen that actually impacted insulin sensitivity actually used 300 and 400 micrograms, and that's closer to what I'm taking. I take a regular supplement. Didn't think to bring the tablet in today, but you can get it in our systems. We've done a lot of work improving our supplements access programs. And again, either I or JR can help you with that, or you can come to the supplements webinar. We've got a webinar on that as well. Now, I tend to take 200 micrograms per day in a supplement, but I also have a morning smoothie, which I put natto in, natto powder. Natto, you may remember, is really icky, bad, vile tasting stuff. At least for most of us, and it was for me for the longest time. When I was the medical director for Toyota North America, I got the chance to visit Japan a few times and tried natto, and it was really bad. Now, when I say that, I get a lot of comments from people that say, no, they really like it. I haven't even really acquired a taste. I can tolerate it now. But anyhow, what I do is I get a bag of fermented soybean natto powder, Amazon. I put a teaspoon of that powder in my morning smoothie. The morning smoothie doesn't have significant calories. It's more of a supplement type of smoothie. And we can cover that again sometime. Someone was asking me about the contents of that. I've got a video that talks about my morning smoothie if you want to take a look. It's a little bit old. I don't know if it includes that natto powder or not. Kevin Gold, what do you think is a safe maximum dose of K2 MK7? Relatively high calcium score. Okay, nuclear stress. You know, I don't think there's a whole lot of, there's clearly no evidence regarding any safety signals from K2. In other words, K2 appears to be fairly harmless. You know, then it becomes a question of, you know, how much makes sense. Like I said, I take relatively higher amounts. Is it going to hurt you to take 600 or 800 micrograms? I'm very skeptical that it is. If it did, I think there would have been signals about that. Why wait for a disease and hope for a cure? I used to be an ER doc. My name is Ford Brewer. I quit ER after a few years because it was just so frustrating. Most of the things bringing people into the ER are things that should have been prevented, including heart attack, stroke, number one cause of death, number one cause of permanent disability. People think that you're just going to have those and that they're not predictable. Both of those are wrong. They are predictable and you don't have to have them. Usually it's lifestyle. Lifestyle is more important than supplements and even prescription drugs and even stents and surgery. But the current times are tough. Major financial impact with the lockdowns that most states have been going through. We've been working on a way to make this much more affordable with a subscription process. And that's exactly what we're announcing today. We've got two levels. One is the Silver membership, where you get access to our courses, a private webinar each month, and access to our supplement store and supplement recommendations and prescription. Or I would suggest even more so, the Gold membership. You can get a script for a freestyle Libre and find out what your blood sugar metabolism's doing on a daily basis. And you can get a lab order for inflammation, OGTT, and insulin survey. You can also get a 30-minute one-on-one with me. So I'm looking forward to seeing you. Cost is no longer an excuse. So if you're interested, go to go.prevmedheartrisk.com/prevmed-subscription or call us at 859-721-1414, 859-721-1414, or email us at myhealth@prevmedheartrisk.com. Looking forward to seeing you. Thank you.